fateful night in February. So with that, I started thinking and discussing and reaching out to various individuals, quietly talking. I want everyone to understand that this is in no way to be a partisan issue, a chamber issue, a political issue. It's one that we all need to come together to think about the best way to address what has been termed a no-knock search warrant. That was what was executed that night that led to a bad set of circumstances and facts. So with that, I started discussing with law enforcement, CAICO, League of Cities, police chiefs, Sheriff's Association about appropriate remedies. And the long and short of it is, and I will get into details, is that from my opinion, and a bill that I currently have in draft that started in draft last week, there is not a place in law enforcement for a no-knock search warrant. And that's the first thing that people need to take away from this. There is and are times which individuals will have to get into, and if people were listening to the current Judiciary Committee, that based on hostage situations, things of that nature, and this is what I've gleaned from police officers, plus 30 years in law practice, there are circumstances where you arrest but not search. So this bill is going to set out the parameters for a secondary mechanism when you are involved in a much broader investigation. One of the things, as one of my colleagues just walked in, Danny Carroll, there may be hostage situations, things of that nature, where you must have an attached search warrant. I'm not going to get down in the details. A search warrant upon arrest that you need to have that ability to search. I can get into more details, but we're not going to go back into a law school class. It would also set up the process for which you would go through the law enforcement agency. If you've looked at Lexington Metro, you must get sign off by a supervisor. Then you take it to a judge. In certain circumstances, people have to go form shopping. If they have been denied by a judge, they should certify that they have been denied when seeking another judge's approval. Then appropriate execution. Upon receiving a warrant that is a warrant where there is the potential for bodily harm, harm to life or limb, that's what I'm talking about obtaining as the primary warrant. You are never going to be able to get a no-knock search warrant, but there would be the necessity of having a search warrant attached to the broader warrant. Execution, then you should have the appropriate people who are there to execute that style of warrant. There are different names for these entities. Some of them call them tactical ops, special ops, SWAT, SRT, but you should have the people who are trained in that. I will also say I've talked to my son, who is in the military, and that is his expertise. Close quarter combat, hostage recapture, and terrorist intervention. They are trained to deal with situations like that and secure residences or buildings or facilities. They know better than anybody else because that's their specialty, and they should be involved in the execution of any type of warrant like that. Then you get to the point where you have now obtained it, you've executed it, but what happens if you do not follow these parameters and go outside? Well, naturally, suppression of any evidence is always something for an inappropriately obtained warrant. That would be one remedy. Second, there would be entity liability. So the entity who employs individuals who do this, they would be financially or civilly responsible. Further, if there is gross or wanton negligence or willful misconduct, the qualified immunity of the officer would be waived and they could be held personally liable. And then last, we need to look at the individual and a process for which that individual or individuals went outside these parameters about their POP certification and a process for which that could be reviewed and, if necessary, suspended or revoked to where they would not be a practicing officer in this state any longer. That is a very brief description of the parameters of the bill that is currently in draft. I have briefed my caucus. I have talked to Senator Neal and others. I've talked to people in law enforcement. But I think the biggest thing here is, one, a search warrant that is based on a no-knock situation would never be applicable or permissible in this state. Two, this is something that going to start the discussion, that we are going to look at other issues. We are going to look and refine this issue, and we are going to do it in a way that is bicameral, bipartisan, and apolitical. So with that, I felt as in my role as the Senate President that I would state that the process is starting, but it is not finished. And appreciate the fact that I have had a lot of input, and now from various entities and individuals, but now we will start the dialogue across the aisle and down with the other chamber. Questions?
When you say that you'll look at other issues, could you expand on that? Are you talking about other issues related to warrants or other issues related to racial justice and equality? Or
I don't want to close it down. There's everything is out there. There is a belief that we need to talk about training, Senator Thayer, de-escalation, you know, what happens in numerous situations. Let's don't limit it. Let's don't in any way say that we will go a certain direction. There may be agreement, there may be disagreement. The biggest thing is that the dialogue is starting. And this is the first step.
You mentioned POP certification as part of this. Do you see that as a problem where officers are maybe leaving a department while under investigation and moving to another department? And that hop around seems to happen a lot.
It has happened. And that is a problem. Again, I don't want to sit here and tell you that I practice that every day, but I have talked to police officers, individuals who are in positions of authority within respective entities or agencies or governmental agencies who have told me that has happened. Resignation and you move to another agency, therefore your POP certification is not reviewed, therefore not revoked, therefore you do not cure the problem, you are just transferring your headache to another agency.
Has there been any discussions about waiving qualified immunity in general for police officers in Kentucky?
There's always the ability to waive. Well, you're saying waive.
Or eliminate.
Remove qualified immunity. There's always ability to move to get rid of qualified immunity, but this would be codified, that this would remove the qualified immunity if there was such gross or wanton negligence or willful misconduct.
And could that potentially be expanded in general, even without the negligence or misconduct?
Could it be expanded?
To where you would just eliminate qualified immunity in general?
I don't know if you want to go that far, because some people act in good faith, and people make mistakes. I don't think anybody up here is going to tell you that they have the market cornered on perfection. But where it is so gross, so wanton, or so willful, I think you have to have a review of that.
Just a minute earlier, you talked about it being nonpartisan, nonpolitical. Do you think you're going to gain support for this bill, not only within your party, but across the other side?
You know, I've spoken to Senator Neal. He's here. I'll step to a side. That's my intent. I believe it is. Virtually everybody I've talked to's intent and desire around what I'm going to call the legislative table.
Good afternoon. I appreciate the tone and the tenor of what the president is putting out here today and that we've discussed. This is not only level of interaction and discussion that's taking on, that's being taken on. There's discussions across the aisle now between various members of this body. I think we agree that this should be a nonpartisan, non-political piece, that we all end this together and we have to do the right thing and get to effective results. You asked the question, and I appreciate the president's reference to this is the starting point or a beginning of this process, because obviously there's a lot more to be done besides no knocks. But no knocks is symbolic of what's has stimulated the reactions in Louisville and across the nation, quite frankly, and around the world even. So that's part of that piece that we have to deal with. But obviously there's a lot of other aspects of what we have to deal with here, and some of it's going to be a lot tougher, I think, than dealing with no knocks or even the question of body cameras and that sort of thing. But what is encouraging here is that now it looks like we have an opportunity, and history will not be kind to us if we do not take advantage of this opportunity to do that which is right and not just stand in our corners and beef about how important our positions are. I think the tone has been set. It's a positive tone. I extend my hand with that. We're already talking. We've had meetings on various issues, opening the doors to work toward these positive results. So again, I think this is an opportunity. It should be seen as a positive step. We may not agree, and I trust we will not agree on all things, but I think we will come together at some point and come up with an acceptable and appropriate product, not just in no knocks, but in other areas as well. Thank you.
Can we expect to see this as a priority legislation next session?
Well, you know, to say priority legislation generally means that is the legislation of the party who is in control of the chamber. I don't want to give it that type of designation because that is generally what we set out as a priority. I want this to be a priority of the legislature, not of the Democrats, not of the Republicans, not of the House, not of the Senate. And hopefully, and what I'm going to say here, hopefully what you're seeing is a pretty broad spectrum of diversity here in general philosophical opinions that for one reason or another have belief in the parameters that I've set forward. You know, are we going to agree on all things going forward? Probably not. That's probably a guarantee. I always say I don't always agree with my wife. Don't always agree with my children, but at least we're talking about the issues, and I think that's another key takeaway. When you see some of us here, I think you all as correspondents and covering the legislature definitely understand that this is a very broad spectrum of political diversity in front of you today.
Who were you working with in the House?
Well, I have actually had more discussions with Senator McGarvey and Senator Neal, along with Senator Julie Rocky Adams, and we are having these discussions. I am certain there are groups in the House who I have reached out to a few. I had a discussion with one of the House leadership last night. There has been communications, and I want to say this came together very quickly, because after the last meeting I had with the Sheriff's Association, the police chiefs, CAICO League of Cities, Jeff Harmon, who is on our staff, we started drafting, and we felt, let's get this out there, let's get the discussion going. So I actually had conversations with, when I say conversations, in this day and age of text, email, I'll say communications with two members of the House so far.
Some people around the country have called for an outright ban on no-knocks, no exceptions. For you, why do you think it's important to consider, including exceptions to the warrant use in the bill?
Now, this is going to get down in the weeds. What I'm talking about is a ban on no-knock search warrants. That's a standalone warrant by itself. It should not be there. As I have David James, who is a former police officer, if you've got a hostage situation, and I think this is pretty much the state of the law, and you have to go in where there is a hostage situation, you will be getting a warrant for arrest and potentially other things that you will get from a detached, neutral magistrate or judge, but there may be the necessity to gather evidence. When you go into that room, Law enforcement is allowed to secure that room and look for things within the immediate control of that person who has created this hostage situation. But you are not allowed to search and seize. You can go into other rooms to secure, but you cannot search and seize. Therefore, there may be the necessity as a secondary warrant, secondary, not primary, not standalone, to have a search warrant there with law enforcement. But that is not the primary purpose, and as the primary purpose, it should not exist.
So fundamentally, with this law, the raid on Breonna Taylor's home, the execution of that warrant,
that would never taken place. The appropriate method, and again, I hope you don't mind, David, but I've talked to him about this. You know, for whatever, we're not talking about whether she was right or wrong, but for whatever was done there, they could have asked her when she came home from work, we have a search warrant. As she walked out of the house the next morning, we have a search warrant. But a no-knock warrant at 1 o'clock at night, that's bad policing. A no-knock warrant in general is not good. And you're looking at most people, and I think we all agree, that is not a good police tactic. It's unsafe for the people there. It devalues people's right to privacy and the sanctity of your home. And it also puts the police officers at risk.
If it was practiced, at some point somebody probably thought it was a good idea. When you say you were talking to law enforcement, did anybody explain why it was used in the first place?
No, because I did not talk to anybody who was involved, and I don't believe it appropriate for me to talk to anybody involved in that situation because there is a continuing ongoing investigation.
Are you looking at possible legislation other states might be doing on this topic?
Naturally, we're always looking for good ideas from other states.
With respect to the last question, warrants of this type weren't in effect. They came in effect the last 25 years of the last century. And it all came out of this whole drug interdiction piece. So that's been an increase in terms of employing these tactics and these tools to deal with those situations. The problem is that when you have warrants, particularly no-knock warrants, whatever you intended from the beginning, actually those circumstances change, or they're likely to change between getting that warrant and coming to that home. So some of the bases by which you even seek them may not even exist at the time you try to serve them. The other thing is that we have a castle doctrine in Kentucky. And the no-knock warrant is in direct contradiction to that particular doctrine. And the castle doctrine, which is rooted in common law, which goes all the way back to England, you can research that particular piece. But the fact of the matter is that that is probably the last place that an individual has that in olden days it was sacrosanct. Now it has been eroded by some of the methods that we've used, not because somebody was ill-intended, but because we employed these tools and human beings and processes and institutions are trying to carry out what they think is their responsibility. And it's gotten muddled in the process, and it's invaded that particular aspect of our laws. So I think, I have to say, you know, no-knock warrants have a long and bloody history. If you look at it across the United States of America, you will find that they're not favored. They're literally not favored. But because of the change of circumstances and the initiatives that have happened federally, then ultimately locally, they've come into existence. So now we have an opportunity. I got to keep saying this word opportunity and how much I appreciate the tone of this, because now we can really talk about things that we know that are right. We know that we have to deal with the question of trust, which is the linchpin of effective policing. We know that there are rights in terms of individuals in their homes, in their neighborhoods, with respect to what officers are. I have no hesitation saying the vast majority of our officers do their job properly, and they do it without favor, and they do it effectively. But the problem is that because of the tools and the policies, the cultures and trainings and or the lack thereof or whatever, now we've had a perfect storm, so to speak, in given situations. That undermines good police work. That undermines what a community should expect. And I think that this is an opportunity for us to get it right.
Senator Neal, if this is a springboard for other reforms, what else would you like to see in 2021?
Well, always keep, fortunately I didn't bring my glasses with me, I'll tell you. You know, I think in terms of police, we need to deal with transparent reporting to the public. I think we should have reporting on various levels. We need recommendations to the appropriate entity for evaluation and action, and establish a broader commission to deal with practices and patterns of behavior in police departments. Because, see, if you look at a situation like Breonna Taylor, that tragedy, or any individual situation, you're really not getting the picture. These are things that have accumulated over time. And to really change those things or get a good view as to what should be changed, you're going to have to look at patterns and practices. And this is not just in Louisville, Kentucky. This is in the holler, so to speak, some people indicate. We need to take a look and be unafraid to look at those things. It's important for us to do this. Again, it's an opportunity. Accountability, independent investigation. This is me now. I'm speaking for myself. I don't want to impute this upon everyone here. The independent investigation of police misconduct, independence being a key. Improved data collection and reporting to the public, not just to the agencies that are involved in that process. Periodic, well, I got into that particular piece, is excessive use of force, de-escalation. I'm glad to hear that that's an issue that is being discussed. Certainly that should be looked at very carefully. Ban on chokeholds. Now, I'm sure there'll be a discussion about that, but in my discussion with police officers, there's rarely a need for a chokehold, but it's used by some routinely and permitted by others, and even when it's banned in a department, they're still used. Well, there should be a consequence for that particular piece, even if there isn't injury, even if there isn't death as a result of that. There should be consequence for using practices that are unacceptable. I could go on and on, and I have some I'd be glad to share with you, but I'm gonna step back and, Mr. President.
Well, I wonder if we could hear from our law enforcement veterans. You know, do you guys have any concerns? Or if not, if your former law enforcement colleagues come to you with concerns, how do you lay those concerns?
Thank you. My name is John Schickel, and I serve in the Senate. I'm from Northern Kentucky and serve on the Judiciary Committee. I'm a former U.S. Marshal, former city and county police officer. And Senator Neal is exactly right about one thing, and this isn't something that just happened with this one case. I believe it has accumulated over time. I think that it is something that's needed, so I'm glad that the Senate President is having the legislation drafted, and he has reached out to a lot of people about it. We talked a little bit about consensus, and I think one of the reasons there's consensus on this issue is because for a lot of people, this is a civil liberty issue. It's an order issue, it's a civil liberty issue, and it's also a safety issue, and it also comes in a no-knock search warrant comes in direct conflict with our current Stand Your Ground law, which we passed several years ago, which I support. So those are all good reasons for reform with search warrants. I've been involved in a lot of search warrants over the years, some as a supervisory role and some of them as a worker bee. And I always thought that there was a need for better, we might say, regulation of search warrants, because the right to be secure in your homes is a fundamental right in the Bill of Rights that we hold sacred both in the Kentucky Constitution, the United States Constitution, but also the Constitution, the Bill of Rights recognizes that there is a need for search warrants. And I think the Senate President does a really good job of differentiating between a search warrant, which is to get evidence, and going to make an arrest of a very dangerous person, which I think is a demarcation that needs to be made. So I'm happy to see this. I think it's a step in the right direction. I would caution you in that I'm here because for search warrants. That's why I'm here, because I agree with this. There's been a lot of other things that have been mentioned. Those are all other topics, and that's not why I'm here. I'm not saying I agree or disagree, but I'm here for this issue because I think this issue is long overdue, and I think it is. I think we'll find a lot of consensus on it.
Good afternoon. My name is Danny Carroll, the state senator from the 2nd District. 24-year law enforcement officer, served a great deal of my career as an investigator, also conducting internal investigations for a few years, commanded a drug unit, and, you know, lengthy experience in these areas. My voice in this is probably going to be more towards a voice of balance and to ensure that before we present final legislation, that we have thorough discussions into each possible scenario that law enforcement could face. I'm not completely sold on totally doing away with search warrants with no knocks. There are times if you're working a homicide case that you may have probable cause to believe that a weapon is in a particular residence. You may not have probable cause to arrest the occupant of that resident. And, you know, it could very obviously be a high risk situation for the officers. I do support a higher level of proof in order to obtain a no knock warrant. And I do support providing that it's our SWAT teams or ERT teams who are specifically trained for these types of incidents and can do it much more safely than a basic street officer or basic investigator. So I look forward to the process. And folks, I don't think you'll find that in the law enforcement community, there is always an evolution of changes in policy and in tactics to go along with what the societal expectations are. So if you hear the discussions within law enforcement, you're going to find a lot of agreement that it is time to look at these things, and especially with the no-knock search warrants, that we do need to reassess where we are. And I commend the Senate President for taking this step forward on behalf of our caucus, and it's good to see that it will be a bipartisan effort. And these are discussions that we need to have. We also need to be mindful that we've got to protect our law enforcement officers also. They have an impossible job, especially today, and to make sure that we find the proper balance as we move forward to protect the citizens, to protect the officers, and to make sure that we create a safe environment as we can while allowing justice to be sought in the end. And that's what it's all about when it comes down to it. But I do commend the efforts, and I look forward to moving the legislation forward and seeing the product once we get done. But you know, I just want to be mindful and push that there is a proper balance obtained through all of this. And I hope that through some of the experience that I've had, that I can bring forth some scenarios that I dealt with for over the years that we need to discuss before making a final judgment.
Got time for one more question.
Regarding the qualified immunity and waiving it, just to clarify, are you talking about if there's, you know, extreme negligence or willful misconduct, that it would qualified immunity would be waived only in cases with a search warrant, like a no-knock search warrant in combination with an arrest warrant? Or are you talking about waiving qualified immunity if there's extreme negligence or willful misconduct in any kind of policing matter?
You raise an interesting question because, first of all, depending on the situation of what you're talking about of so gross or wanton conduct or willful misconduct, it is going to be fact specific. So this is going to be limited to this type of fact situation because the reason that I want to limit it to that is because we can start thinking up a lot of scenarios, and Senator Carroll has talked about some of them and why this discussion needs to take place. The question becomes is, this is a volatile situation where there's extreme risk to all parties involved. Now, depending on where you go and what else the police officer may be involved in, the risk may not be so high. So I don't want to sit here and try to do a blanket type of recommendation, but the risks are very high in these situations. Therefore, you should have standards that match the risk.
President Sivers, real quickly, unrelated to this, I just want to get your take on this, is where do you stand on mandating Kentuckians to wear masks during the pandemic?
Who's doing that?
Nobody right now. I'm just curious where
I don't. I don't want to comment on hypothetical situations.
Several other states have, so.
I understand that.
Is that something that you believe is necessary?
It depends on the circumstances, and you're asking me to comment on a hypothetical situation. You know, what are the circumstances for which you are doing that? I know some states are doing it specifically in counties. because there has been increased or elevated numbers of the coronavirus. Other counties, they aren't. So they're differing with inside states. So I'm not going to sit here and play a game of saying, oh, hypothetically, are you for or against? Let's see what the circumstances are and the parameters that surround those types of situations.
Have you spoken to the governor about at all about what he plans to announce this afternoon?
No, I did tell him about this, though.
You did?
Yes, and in fact, discussed with some of his administration about some of the theories behind this, and appreciate their candor with me.